Okay, good evening to all. So today's presentation is on breeding for cross-pollinated crops. So yesterday discussion mostly we concentrated on self-pollinated crops. So today discussion mostly on the cross-pollinated crops. Okay, so breeding for cross-pollinated crops, what are the criterias? What are the basic concepts you should know? And what are the people, what are the methodology people are adopting for the cross-pollinated crops you should know? So can you know which are all the cross-pollinated crops? In the first slide itself I given maize. It is one of the popular crop which is a cross-pollinated nature. And we have pearl millet, we have melon, we have cucumber. In this cassava, there are a lot of crops here in the cross-pollinated crops. Many of the vegetable crops are bee pollinated, which are all having highly cross-pollinated nature. So the cross-pollinated crops also have very huge commercial value because when you work on crops, when you work on the cross-pollinated crops, you can have highly commercially important because you can easily develop the hybrids. So the hybrids will fetch big market price whenever you develop a new hybrids, and when you release in the market, it have more value. So the even though the maintenance of purity of the cross-pollinator crops is very tough job, because it's always whenever we are not self-pollinate or we are protected pollination is not there, your variety, you cannot maintain the inbred lines or the varieties in your pure conditions. So always if it is a pollinated by honeybees or wind pollination, many pollination methods, so everything will affect your purity of the crop. That is the first thing. Another thing, when you are not maintaining, then your lines become mixture. So that is one of the biggest problem when maintaining the cross-pollinated crops. Apart from like self-pollinated crops, even though if you are not doing selfing, it's have 99% self-pollination will be there. So another advantage is that you have commercial value, because when you make a two proper parents, when you develop a hybrid, it's going to fetch biggest price in the market. So that's why everybody in the public sector and the private sector, the people are nowadays investing huge money on developing your hybrids, and these hybrids have very big potential in the market. Okay, so coming to the maize, let us have a few slides discussion on the maize. It's one of the key crop. Apart from rice, wheat, maize is the highest acreage in the world, and it has very huge yield potential also. So the maize, normally they develop hybrids. So most of the area in the maize is that developed countries or developing countries, most of the area is occupied by hybrids, not like composites or synthetics. That is on earlier days, 10 years or 20 years back. Still some of the land races, still they maintain as a composite or synthetic. Okay, how they develop their hybrids. So the F1, why we go for the cross-pollinated crop, we go for hybrids. Hybrids always have the hybrid bigger, and it have more advantage for the yield for many of the traits we are looking. For example, when you look any maize plant, when it is in the open pollinated variety, earlier days we have open pollinated varieties. When you look on this open pollinated variety 1, this case in the open pollinated variety 2, so when the open pollinated varieties, when you self it, because anyhow you can maintain your line, for that you have to self it and maintain it. Sometimes the open pollinated variety, if you grow in isolation, then it can able to maintain it bigger. When you collect the pollen from tassel and dust it on the silk female part, then whenever you do one selfing, the plant vigor will be reduced, because that's why we call it as inbreeding depression. So when you self it, normally the depression will be there. Similarly, the another open pollinated variety, if you do selfing and again it become inbreeding depression will be there, and it become short, vigor will be reduced. Okay, now you may be asking the question, why not we maintain as a like open pollinated variety? Yes, you can maintain as a open pollinated variety, but the yield potential which you may not get as like hybrids. So the open pollinator varieties, earlier days before hybrids came into market, it's been maintained by traditionally by the land races or the people continuously cultivating the maize crop. They maintain a open pollinator variety. But when the breeding system improved, they tried to self-feed and maintain a pure line, that is we call it as inbred line. After one or two self-feed, it will be maintained as a pure line. Once you get two different inbreds, and if you make a crosses, then you will get a hybrids. So the hybrid will, when you, even after we have inbreeding depression and the inbreds are maintained, but when you make a cross between two inbreds, your hybrid will be catartic one. That means it has huge potential. The only thing is that you have to choose the inbreds which are diverse in nature. That means it's a diverse nature. You have from different gene pool. Then all the genes together and it will give you a heterotic effect. So that is one advantage when you go for the hybrids. The hybrid cultivar development, when you develop the hybrids, you need inbred line, which I seen in the earlier slide. We need inbred line. That means a pure line. If it is an open pollinated variety, you have to self-feed, make it a pure line. That we call it as inbred line. So the inbred line, utility of inbred line determined by its genetic contribution to the hybrid when crossed with another inbred line. That means two combinations, best two combinations, diverse inbred make a best hybrid. So the cross inbred line into a tested, measure the company. You have to test the each inbred line, whether it have potential or not. You have to test with some standard inbreds, whether how much potential it is. So that is the one important thing. Always they do test cross and see that your inbred is better or not. So the test cross, Texcrot experimental hybrids over the years and location they do it. And then they fix which inbred you have to use it. Then if the particular combination of inbred give higher yield level heterosis, then that will be used for the seed production program. So you can increase the inbred line seed and go for hybrid seed production plot. So when you go to the farmer's field, the people ask every time, can I buy the hybrid? Why should I buy the hybrid every time? Because it's costly and you cannot produce your own seed, because every time you are making a crosses between two inbreds and the hybrid seeds are produced. So if the farmers don't have the parental line, because they don't have the right to have the parental line, because it's a unique combination. So that is the one thing. Second thing, if the farmers always has to buy the hybrid seeds every time, whether it's a public sector or private sector, that is very important. Every time they have to. Why? Because F1 hybrids are, it's express heterosis, it is homogeneous material and it has very good yield potential. Okay, what happened if you use the own seed? If you buy the F1 seed and harvest after sowing the crop, if you get F1, F1 is harvested, then try to use this F1 seed, but that seed always, if you sow next generation, it shows segregation. That means heterotic will be 50%, remaining 50%, 25-25 segregate like male and female. So the vigor of 50% of the population will be reduced. That means if you have the average yield of 10 tonners in the maize, but per hectare, if you use the F2 seed, then you cannot get the 10 tonners, maybe 6 tonners or 5 tonners yield. So it will be drastically reduced. That's why every time they go for the new hybrids. Hybrid seeds, every time they buy in the market and you have to use it, either a public or private sector. So the crosses, they use normally, they produce the seeds in the hybrid seed production plot. That means you have to raise male and female and you have to produce the crop. Okay. There are different hybrid type of hybrids are there. Normally, present day, we use only single cross hybrid. That means one elite inbred as a female, another inbred like male, A and B, then you make your crosses and you get a hybrid. Inbred A, inbred B, you have to raise in isolation and you can produce a hybrid. So that is a single cross hybrid, we call it as. But in the market, there are different type of hybrids are there. Double cross hybrid, three-way cross hybrid, modified three-way cross hybrid. These are all the hybrids still few companies are doing, some public sector institution are doing. For example, in case of TNA released hybrid, CoHM 5, it is having three-way crosses. Similarly, the present day Co6 hybrid is single cross hybrid, only two parent, that is UMI 1200 and UMI 1230. There are two parents being used to produce a single cross hybrid, Co6, Co6, Co8 and Co9. All the current hybrids in the market were released by KNIU, a single cross hybrid. Similarly, the private hybrids like NK6240 or M900 Gold, all the private sector hybrids also, most of them are single cross hybrid. Some have a little bit single cross modified. So how the single cross hybrid is easy to produce, because you have one inbred A and B. If you grow in isolation, only the remove the female plants, you have to remove the tassel, so make it as a female. So male part are removed, and if you grow in isolation of 500 meters isolation, you will get a hybrid seed which harvested from female is a hybrid. But the problem is, if it is a single cross hybrid, it's easy to produce. But the people also produce double cross hybrid also. How to produce a double cross hybrid? Make a cross between two inbreds, A and B. Then you have a separate seed, you have type F1 seed. And again, another cross, you can, another two inbreds, inbred C and D, you make a cross. First, to make a cross between A and B. And also separately, another isolation field, you make a cross between C and D. Then again, this between two, you will get some hybrid seed. Those A and to B F1 hybrids are raised. Similarly, C and D F1 also raised. And again, the pollen from this one fertilize on the female of AB. Then you will harvest the seed. Then it become a double cross hybrid. So this case, the double cross hybrid takes two seasons. Instead of producing one season, you have to produce one season separately AP, and another location you have produced C and D. The next season you have to take this F1 and this F1, make it a double cross hybrid. Same way, three-way cross hybrid also been developed. That means they may cross A and B one season and C multiplied separately one inbred. After that, A and B being crossed with the C, that we call it as three-way cross hybrid. So double cross hybrids are there, three-way cross hybrids are there, modified three-way cross hybrid also there. That means the line which another inbred which you are using, they have the little bit modification, and they are able to get the hybrid. Okay, so that means this kind of hybrid system is available, but presently the single cross hybrid and sometimes the double cross hybrids also in the market. Most of them presently are single cross hybrid. How these hybrids really give the, so you may be wonder, how the hybrids only is showing so much of heterosis. When you look on the inbreds, it's so weak. And when you sow the F1 seeds, then you'll get a very, very, very good vigor on the F1. That we call it as dominance hypothesis. For example, parent 1, the inbred 1 we are getting, some locus you have dominant allele B, small a, so capital B, small c, capital D, small e. That means B locus and D locus are showing dominance. In the parent 2, there are A locus, C locus and E locus showing dominance. So you are utilizing the dominance, the dominant nature of the B and D locus, and also A, C, E and locus all together. When it comes to the F1, all are in heterozygous condition, A, B, C, D, E. So many like that, you can have more than 30 or 40, many genomic regions which have heterotic. So because of that, all the advantages of A and all the advantage of B, that is parent 1 and 2, when you get in the F1 conditions, both are expressed, all are expressed. This is called the dominant allele. Unfavorable alleles are covered up by the heterozygous. Those unfavorable allele, because of the heterozygous nature, that unfavorable conditions are covered up. So you're always getting the hybrid with highest number of high vigor, and you can use it for the high yield varieties, hybrids. Okay. So the hybrid breedings, here the hybrids are crossed of two inbreds are genetically different from germplasm pool. That is two different groups. If you use very narrow, nearest to inbred, very closely related individuals, always your F1s will not get a heterotic one. That's why they're telling that in the human genetics also, there is a diverse, if the marriage between two diverse families, always get a heterotic individuals. Otherwise, you will get a inbreeding depression and sometimes unfavorable alleles try to express. That's why so many genetic disorders are coming. When you go for large scale seed productions, there is not only the rice maize crop, the right cross pollinated crop like maize, it is easy to develop a hybrid because male and female part are separated in the plant, and you can easily remove the male part with less labor cost. You can easily remove it. Like cotton, the people remove the petal and they make it because the petals are stamens are attached to the petal. Epipetal stamen, you can remove it and you can do so manually. People doing the hybridization in case of cotton. Similarly, in case of maize also manually you can do large scale seed production. But problem is some of the crops like pearl millet, there is a cytoplasmic genic male sterility system, CGMS system is there. You have to use a male sterile system in order to develop a hybrids. So that case, sometimes it is very difficult to remove the male part or female part. If it is a male and female are in the same inflorescence and it's difficult to remove, then that case you have to go for cytoplasmic genic male sterility system. So if they did that, for that you need a separate lines, male sterile line, maintainer line and restorer lines are needed to develop the hybrids. Anyhow, whatever may be the case, when you develop for any hybrids, you need to develop the inbred lines. So inbred line, every time you have to test their combining ability and then choose for the superior hybrid development. So the hybrids, that is very important. How in case of pearl millet or sorghum, pearl millet is a common cross-pollinated crop. So how the pearl millet hybrid seed production be doing? I already told you, male sterile system is very important system by which you can do commercial seed production easily. How they are doing? We need a A-line, male sterile line. In that, cytoplasm is a recessive condition, that is, it is on the mostly the mitochondrial genome. It's recessive MSMS, and it has nuclear also recessive gene. That is, the restorer gene is recessive condition. So it becomes male sterile. So when there is a restorer line, the genes which is present in the nucleus have dominant nature of RF gene, that restorer gene, then it will have the fertile plant. But it is a recessive condition, so it has become male sterile. So male sterile have small RF, and also cytoplasm having the male sterile gene, so it becomes male sterile. So this male sterile, when you grow the plant, you always sterile, you will not get seeds. So this can be used as a female. But how to maintain this male sterile line is a question. The maintaining the male sterile line, you have maintainer line, that is B line, that is male fertile line. This have the cytoplasm have the dominant nature. So when you cross between this male sterile line and the maintainer line, you will always get this. The pollen will be fertile, in this case B line, and the pollen will be fertilized on A, and you will get a seed which is again a male sterile line because it's a cytoplasm is female is cytoplasm here. So it derives small ms, and when it is been pollen grain fall on this segment, you will always get the female line, male sterile line, which can produce the seeds. Okay, so you are maintaining the male sterile line with your male counterpart, but in case of, so whenever if you have, maintaining the A line is one important because you need always the seed of female line for hybrid seed production. So that's why we use maintainer line to produce male sterile line always. Okay, when you come to a hybrid, this male sterile line been crossed with the restorer line, that is we call it as OR line. It have restorer gene capital RF. When the pollens are dust on the male sterile line, it become capital RF, small RF. Then the cytoplasm, whatever may be, it can able to get there because it's female and pollen dusted from the male restorer line, it can able to restore the fertility, and you will get F1 will be a hybrid, which is a fertile one. So the people want to do the hybrid seed production in case of pearl millet, you need A line, you need maintainer line B line, and you need OR line. Again, selection of A line is very important. Particular combination of A line and OR line is very important. Then only you will get a best hybrids for the seed production. So A line and B line are looks almost isogenic line except for fertility. B line will be a fertile one and A line will be sterile one. Always A line need the pollen from B line and it fertilize and you can able to get the mean A-line seeds. Okay. So whenever if you go for hybrid seed production plot, you need A-line and also R-line. This is the pearl millet seed production plot. You have the male line, three male line, four rows of normally they have female, two rows of male line. So male will be a fertile pollen, female have sterile pollen. So pollen fall on this stigma and it covers the seeds which are from hybrid seeds. So that's why the pearl millet hybrids been produced. So another one more thing which I want to tell you is, it's Kambu Napier hybrids also, one of the important thing which people use interspecific hybrids, which you already seen in our forage crop department. A lot of Kambu Napiers are very been cultivated. How they develop? The Penicetum glaucum is diploid 2N14 and been crossed with Penicetum purpureum. Purpureum is a Napier grass. It is a highly cross nature. This is the Kambu. So Penicetum glaucum crossed with purpureum. And when we manually, if you cross it, then you will get a Kambu Napier hybrid. It is a triploid. That is 14 and 24. So you will get a N is 7. So here N 2N24. So you will get a triploid hybrid, Kambu Napier hybrid. It becomes sterile one. You will not get any seed. So this is by vegetatively propagated. So once you get a better hybrid, Kambu Napier hybrid, triploid hybrid, then this can be multiplied by cloning. There are Bajra Napier hybrid, BN1, BN2, CO1, CO2, CO3. There are a lot of hybrids available in the market. It's one of the famous hybrids are TNAU hybrids or the Kambu Napier hybrids is grown throughout the world. So here, even though if we develop, this is a heterotic vigor will be very high. Kambu is very small. Napier grass also not so attractive. But when you make a cross between Kambu and Napier, you will get a multi-cut fodder, which have high fodder value in case of Kambu Napier hybrid. Here also, the heterotic potential we are realizing, it's a triploid nature and the heterotic hybrids are there, but again, choosing the parents are very important. Okay. So coming to these kind of cross-pollinator crops, we should know what are the crops available, how we can manipulate, what is the breeding method they are using, how we are manipulating this one. We have alfalfa, cassava, maize, forage grasses, pearl millet, rye, safflower, even sunflower is a highly cross-pollinator, you know, beet pollination is there, sugarcane, sugar beet, carrot, brassica, cucumber, melon, onion, pepper, potatoes, sweet potatoes, squash, and tree, some of the other food crops. So many horticulture crops, apart from that cereals, we have maize and pearl millet, oil seed, we have sunflower, safflower, and we have sugarcane, sugar beet, and many, many crops, cassava, there are many crops are normally cross-pollinated. So these crops are having high commercial value. The many seed companies, they are working on that. Okay. So coming to the two concepts, I am going to explain only a few concepts for the cross-pollinator crops today, because I don't want to put you very complex breeding concepts. I want to make it a very simple this class. Normally, the genetic composition of cross-pollinator crops, here the open pollinator plant, if it is a open pollinator variety, when you self it and put it in a progeny, the plant's open pollinator form, when you self it and put it in your individual progeny, always you can see that there are a lot of variation in the height, crop character, many character you can see variation. This is because of selfing, because it's a mixture line. So when you self it, you'll get a lot of segregation. So people try to select from this one and they try to use it. Since the cross-pollinator plants are heterozygous nature, whenever in the normal land races or when it is in the normal location, it always heterozygous nature because always you get the pollen from different sources. So the normally when you self those open pollinator variety, always it segregate and it show wide variation in the phenotype. In case of rice self-pollinator crops, if you self also, there is not much variation in the progeny. Once you make a crosses and then select, you can get variation. But in case of cross-pollinator crops, always heterozygous nature. So when you self it, you'll get wide range of phenotype. So again, one more disadvantage, when you continuously selfing, vigor become reduced and it become inbreeding depression. So the breeding systems are designed to increase the desirable allele, particularly mainly for quantitative inheritance. So the desirable alleles for quantitative traits are very important. So the repeated cycle of selection, we call it as recurrent selection, being applied to increase the frequency of favorable allele. This is the one I told you, when the maize are self, first generation, it's an open pollinated heterozygous variety. When you self it, continuously if you self it goes on, it will depress completely in breeding depression. But it attain homozygosity, but it will do the inbreeding depression. What they do people, after a few generation of selfing, they try to make a sip mating, off sip and full sip. They sip mate it, related progeny, then they maintain the vigor. So this way the people reduce the effect of inbreeding. Another thing, when you look for the recurrent selection, original population is like this, when there is a number of individuals which have the number of individuals and bottom this one is oil content one case. So when the original population, the oil content, when they select it is around 30 plants. When again second cycle of selection, this slowly move to the increased number of desirable traits we will select, and same time every selection we go for best plants. By that you can increase the number of frequency of plants which have higher yield or higher oil content will be possible if you do continuous recurrent selection. So recurrent selection increase the frequency of desirable gene with your population, and it has been developed in 1940s in maize, it demonstrated, and it's from original open pollinator variety. They tried to do the recurrent selection, and the recurrent selection, one cycle of recurrent selection, second cycle of recurrent selection, when you compare, the second cycle of recurrent selection hybrids are superior, and that's why they adopted the theory and tried to practice the recurrent selections for the superior allele selection. I will show you this, how the recurrent selection been done in the cycle 1 and cycle 2. For example, on cycle 1, when you grow a plant, open OPV varieties, when the maize means, and you choose the plant at the time of maturity, superior line, among all the progenies, even though it shows segregation, you select only the superior. For example, look for better crop, select the best crop, highest test weight, you select it, and this will be the selected progenies. You raise it for next year and allow for planting in the intercross block, allow for intermating. So again, selected lines, you plant again and allow for intermating and re-establish the equilibrium. This is the recurrent selection cycle 1. Recurrent selection cycle 2 also, again, this circumstance of the planted material, again you select superior types for the maturity or the time of maturity for yield, best crop, select it, and again you plant it and allow for intercrossing, so that it will establish the yield equilibrium. So after two cycle of recurrent selection, you get your plants which always, most of them are the higher yield potential and also have desirable character. This is why the recurrent selection principle people are working. So the growing of 10,000 plants in the season 1 and allow for open pollination and select the best plant, and then you bulk it and grow for next season, again bulk it. So this is the simple recurrent selection procedure. The simple selection, recurrent selection is easy, and also for pollination, mass selection, and also there are limitations in this because the number of genotype you can handle will be limited in case of simple recurrent selections. So the cross-pollinator crops we already discussed, the open pollinator varieties, you do the selection, recurrent selection, or simple general mass selection or simple recurrent selection, you develop elite varieties. Or sometimes you make a two source population and you could do the crop sip or full sip and make a progeny test or test cross, and also you can develop a elite varieties. So this is the method they follow. When you come into the cross-pollinator crops like maize, the opposite family selection, year to row selection is the common method they follow. Season 1, they grow 550 to 500 plants in a source population, allow for random intermating, then harvest from the individual seeds. From individual seeds, they grow as a opposite progeny rows. They grow as a progeny row. So seeds are harvested from single plant, and the progenies may be replicated. This will be replicated different places and find out which progeny, opposite progeny, which have the because we know only the female, male we don't know. Opposite means female, we know which plant, but male where the pollen comes we don't know. That's why we call it as opposite family. So the female again is rising in your progeny rows and find out which progeny is better. So those progenies, you select the remaining seeds and make it a bulk and go for next generation. This way the Hoppe-Seq family selection year to row method is followed. So you can evaluate more than one macro environment, and also it need more expensive, more time laborious, and also this is Hoppe-Seq family selection also been followed. Then Hoppe-Seq selection also, they do some modifications, and also they doing this Hoppe-Seq modification selection also deep. So the modified Hoppe-Seq selections, they increase one season per cycle, and this is again little bit modification. The one more component is Hoppe-Seq selection with progeny test. Sometimes when you select the Hoppe-Seq family, they do progeny test. For example, the good looking plants you are selected and let them intercross, these progenies, the second season you know the progenies, and these progenies whichever selection, these progenies which is best you want to know. For that they do the selected plants, they do test cross, test the selected plants in isolation, and if it is at, if you all the progenies, some progenies, test cross progenies doing better, only those progenies you make it a, select those progenies alone and make it a composite, and this is the way they do the Hoppe-Seq selection with progeny test. This is the one method. So the test cross evaluation in the cross pollinator crops, always they do for progeny test, always they do the progeny test, and each generation recombinant segregants for multiple traits, and always they do the test crosses, and the test cross involve selected parents genetically defined test. Normally when you want to test it, keep one standard inbred as a tester. So every time for 10 or 20 lines you want to test with one particular single male, then you know that among the female 20 or 30 female you are testing, making a test cross, which will be the better. So make a common male and number of females being selected, when you make a test cross, you know which is the best female line which you're having. So by that the Hoppe-Seq selection which test cross been followed. So Hoppe-Seq selection with the test cross, normally this is the diagram. So selected plants, they do the test cross and they do progeny testing. So among the progenies, which progeny is better, then they choose it. That is the superior plant selected and allowed for open pollinate and self and crossed with the tester. This is the method normally Hoppe-Seq selection with test has been followed. So the this case Hoppe-Seq family using, when you do the test crossing, you know which are all the poor progenies that can be eliminated. So when you make a test cross with recessive, then you know this is heterozygous condition, then it is segregating. So you can easily differentiate which progeny have some inferior allele that can be rejected, this test cross progeny will do. But one of the disadvantages, you need 2 to 3 cycles, you have to do that. Okay. So the another one is the full sweep selection. So I already so far talked about Hoppe-Seq. So when you talk at the Hoppe-Seq, you know the only female, but when you call it as a full sweep selection, this case, you know male and female. So we make a crosses between two variety, you know what is female, what is male, and you check it progenies. Similarly, intercross again, this is a female, another is a male. So all possible combination you're making crosses, you know what is a male, what is a female. So those male, that F1 hybrids are evaluated. So among that, which combination is better, which specific combination is better, so that hybrid is being used as a further process. So this way the full sweep progeny test always have advantage. You have added genetic variability between two diverse parents, and if you involve more number of inbreds has to be tested, then you can able to easily identify superior plants and you can do full selection. So this full sweep also always they go for the progeny test in order to know how this full sweep is working. So this case, and also they do for progeny test, and they select the best progenies, and then it will be used for the progress. So I will stop with this today's discussion. So today our discussion is mostly on the how the cross pollinator crops, see reciprocal recurrent selection and full sweep Hoppe-Seq families, how they are testing. By that they identify how the best hybrids